Welcome to the third of the College of Ag seminars. Today, I'm pleased that we'll hear from the Horticulture and Landscape Architecture Department. Again, this seminar series is designed for us across the college to get to know what each other's doing, and also to think about some areas where we can, with small investments, become globally preeminent, as our dean would say. So today, from the Horticulture and Landscape Architecture Department, Steve Newman's going to lead off, and then he's going to be followed by a panel of speakers: Adam Huberger, Dave Holm, Jane Choi, and Bill Burley. Did I say that right, Bill? Bowerly. Okay, thank you. I'll let him go.
Well, welcome. My name is Steve Newman. I've in the Horticulture Landscape Architecture Department, and with great pleasure, I'd like to introduce our panel. First, I'd like to introduce Dr. Steve Wallner, and recognize Dr. Steve Wallner, who will be retiring this year after 20 years of service to CSU and to the Horticulture and Landscape Architecture Department. And with will be Adam Huberger, Dave Holm, Jane Choi, and Bill Bowerly. One of the things in our department of Horticulture and Landscape Architecture, is we focus on plants and landscapes that define our human culture. And thinking back of the human culture, we look at the art and history of horticulture, best described in modern art, in historical art. You go back into history, you look at all the still life photographs, still life drawings, a lot of fruit, food, and crops and crop agriculture go back millennia of time. And also looking at the artwork, we can see this village street urban environment, which involves our landscape architecture group. So what is horticulture? Horticulture is the science and art of the production of fruits, vegetables, ornamental plants, blooming plants, flowering plants. What separates horticulture from botany is that we also look at the aesthetics as well as the science, and we look at the economics and the business models of making a living from growing plants and growing plants for food consumption. And when we talk about ornamental plants, we also talk about food for the soul. Our department focuses on research problems for real people, and it's one of the things that our department is focused on for more than 100 years. You go back into the historical photographs in the historical archives for Colorado State University, horticulture seems to be a running trend and always involve people. Horticulture is the before, during, and after vegetable and fruit production. We look at the inputs of water, inputs of energy, inputs of germplasm, growing those plants. What is the production? How do we grow the plants well? How do we grow the most efficient plants? How do we grow the highest quality plants? We look at the post-harvest physiology. How do these resulting fruit, primarily our potato industry, how do the fruits, or how we preserve our fruit? And how do we maintain it for long term? And what are the effects of the fruits and vegetables on health? Looking at, and also how landscape and ornamental plants impacts the health and well-being of people. So to do that, we work with seed producers, both our seed producers of cucurbits, seed producers of potatoes. We work with our growers, our vegetable growers, our fruit growers, our ornamental growers. We work with the processors, the processing industry, primarily in our potato growers, and how they handle the plant materials post-harvest. We also work with many of our vegetable farms, how that processing and producing of the food and getting that food to the consumer in a safe, in a highly productive way, so that our growers make money and we are producing a good quality product for the population of our state. We also have to think about ornamentals. Like I said, ornamentals are, when we talk about ornamentals, we're talking about woody plants, we're talking about herbaceous plants, we're talking about bedding plants, we're talking about the environment. And many points of our lives, we deal with ornamental plants, all the way from how does the trees impact our environment, poinsettias and crops, many of our crops that we're looking at are focused around our religious celebrations, and everybody needs to have flowers at their wedding, you know, wedding, and also look at the end of life for funerals, as well as flowers for everyday consumption. Horticulture is about plants that define our culture. You know, we have one of the preeminent annual bedding plant trials in the United States. Our program, our research gardens at the in front of the Performing Arts Center, is one of the leading sites to visit in the state of Colorado. In fact, TripAdvisor ranks it as, was it third?
Number seven.
Seven. I guess I should look at my screen. Let me pull my glasses. Seven. AARP's got us listed at third, I think. But TripAdvisor's got us at number seven. And so that just tells you a little bit of an idea of the impact our department has on the economy of Northern Colorado. Horticulture is also about turf, turf grass. And the Bronco Stadiums, for instance, is a natural grass turf stadium. And we also do a lot of work with golf. In other words, turf is a very important part of our industry. In fact, golf courses, some of the work by Yiling Chen has shown that golf courses are a carbon sequestration sink of a significant amount to store carbon in our environment. And when you start thinking about quality turf, you can see how poor quality turf helped the Broncos. What is landscape architecture? And landscape architecture is hard for any single definition, but my definition of landscape architecture is designing spaces in our environment for the interaction of people in our environment, whether it be in public gardens, all the way down to the human scale or small scale, all the way down to the home. So it's a working with the aesthetics, working at intimate scales, looking at urban parks, working with streetscapes, looking how humans interact with their environment in the outdoors. And part of our work in our department focuses on those scales. Civic scale, our own oval is one of the classic examples of classical landscape architecture. And working at regional scales, when we look at Frederick Law Olmsted's Emerald Green Park and Central Park in New York City, we're creating a world that we want to live in, creating a world where we can survive and work in our environment. Landscape architecture is about urban sustainability, making sure that we control appropriate management of water, appropriate management of runoff. These are some swales that are designed to catch stormwater, but also creates a pleasant environment for people working with wetlands such as that to maintain a good urban environment. So what we're focusing on is healthy plants, healthy landscapes. Our research programs include at the molecular, physiological, and microbial level, working with our field and greenhouse and nursery production, working with ornamental turf, trees, and flowers, focusing on landscape design theory and how we can better implement these activities for the environment and for our people, working on urban systems, working with the Institute for the Built Environment, and working on large-scale ecosystems on a more global, regional, and global scale. So example stakeholders of our group, when you look at the fruit and vegetable growers, we have about 2,500 growers in the state of Colorado, 350 growers that are organic, looking at an economic impact at the farm gate, over $300 million. The green industry includes all the way from the bedding plant growers to the nursery growers, garden centers, landscape contractors, all the way to the contractors that come in and take care of the turf, urban systems such as that. $1.8 billion direct impact based upon research from Dom Thilmany in the Department of Agriculture and resource economics. And we add the multipliers of the impact of that industry is $3.3 billion on the state of Colorado. So where are we in Fort Collins? Where are we at Colorado State University? So this is a picture that kind of emphasizes where our university gardens start is at Montfort Quad, at their Ag Quad, where we have Shepherdson on the north. We have NESB, Natural Environmental Sciences Building, to the east, which houses our landscape architecture team. We have the Plant Environmental Research Center, which is being converted to a football stadium. And parts of the football stadium that we're retaining include our botanical gardens, our arboretum. And then we have our new center, the Horticulture Center, which is on the 1707 Center Avenue, which is just directly southwest of the Hilton. And if anybody wants a tour, just give me a call. I'll be happy to show off what we've managed to build in less than a year. So this gives you an example of the breadth and the impact that our department has on the campus. We have a brand new Horticulture Center, which is cutting art. It's a 21,000 square foot facility, 6,000 square feet of classrooms and lab spaces, and a 6-acre outdoor garden and research space. We have moved into the greenhouse facilities, and we've installed brand new state-of-the-art light technology working with Philips Lighting. So our greenhouses have changed since 1949. This is a picture of the Plant Environmental Research Centers as they were built in 1949. And comparing to what we have today. So we're making changes, we're keeping up with the state of the art, and moving into modern LED light systems. This is a new inner lighting technology that's used for high wire vegetables, and we'll talk about that with hops as well. We did produce a poinsettia crop this first year, so the facility is up and running, and we're still, as I like to say, kicking the tires. We have a hort farm as part of the RDEC facility on Mountain Vista Drive across from the Budweiser Center, where we have a research with horticulture crops as well as several agronomic crops as well. We're working with high tunnels, and we have our research centers. Our department is heavily invested in research center technology, research center scientists, and we have work at the San Luis Valley Research Center. We have work at the Orchard Mesa Research Center, and we have work at the Arkansas Valley Research Center. Our research also includes the aesthetic research and design studios in our landscape architecture program. Our department by the numbers, we have 27 faculty, 11 AP staff, research associates, and individuals in the main office. We have around 50 graduate students, and we currently have 297 undergraduates in our department. Some 2012 research that was conducted by Texas A&M University shows that over a 10-year period, our department was the fastest growing department with undergraduate enrollment in the United States. So we have a rapidly growing program, lots of significant interest in our program, and when Texas A&M did the work, they thought they'd be number one. As an Aggie, I can say that. So focusing on our big bets, we're looking for and striving for global preeminence in our programs. Looking at the microbiomes, the phytobiome in food and ornamentals. Sustainable futures, a more resilient landscape, more resilient crop production, working with good plants, crop production, good soil health, humans, healthy foods, healthy livable cities, natural environments, and focusing on food quality and food safety. These big bets align with the land grant mission and support all the existing programs at Colorado State University. So at this point, I'll step aside for Adam.
Can you all hear me? Great. I'm Adam Huberger. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Horticulture. So I want to kind of start out by explaining how we decided to organize this presentation. So we received an email saying, all right, it's up to your department to put together a presentation to describe your department. And you can imagine that email came with a lot of collective groaning. But after that, and the groaning was because it's really hard to take everyone in the department and try to say, how do you do that? And our first thought was, well, maybe let's just put everyone alphabetically and go one by one and see if we can torture the audience. And that's not a very good idea. So instead, we decided to think about science, you know, and really what's common themes in science that apply to our department. What I'm talking about is the science of scale. So that's the beauty of science, is that you can look at it on a very small scale. So you can look at molecules. You can, in respect to horticulture, you can look at it in a slightly larger scale. You can look at plants, plant physiology. Go a little bigger. You can put plants in a community. You're on a farm. You take that farm. You put it inside a building. You're in a greenhouse. You then look at plants with respect to an urban environment, and suddenly you're at the city scale. And then you can look at plants with respect to more macro environments, such as in ecosystems. And so that's how we design the rest of this presentation, is each one of us is going to present a different scale that exists within our department. So I am a plant biochemist by training, and so I'm going to present on biochemistry and molecular biology that happens in our department. So I'm going to start out not by going at a small scale, but taking that small scale and putting it underground, or even smaller. And so when we think of the ground, we usually think of it's something that we walk on. Our most intimate association may be on a hike, or if you're in your backyard planting a plant, you get a little bit in there. But when you think of a plant, its association with the ground is half of its existence is down there. And when that happens, it's also interacting with a suite of soil microbes. And so we have a professor in our department, Jorge Vivanco, who runs the Center for Rhizosphere Biology. So he studies that below-ground interaction. And the interaction between plants and soil microorganisms. And what he's finding is, well, there are neutral interactions. That is, a plant and a microbe, they hang out, they're okay with each other, nothing really happens. But then there can be pathogenic interactions. There could be microbes in the soil that could be detrimental to plant growth and development, ultimately food production. But then there's also beneficial microorganisms. So these are going to be microbes that have a good effect on plant growth and development and could potentially improve yield or quality. And so his research is really focused on being able to shift from pathogenic to beneficial microorganism communities. So in my own work, I'm also looking at a plant microbial interaction with respect to plants and how they interact with pathogenic fungi and pathogenic bacteria. So the picture on the left is a bean leaf, and it's infected with a pathogen called Sclerotinia sclerotiorum. This is a fungal pathogen that infects over 400 different species. It doesn't care what it's on, it just goes to town, and it kills it. And so what we're finding in our lab is that there are certain bean varieties, and I should mention this is a collaboration with Mark Brick, who's our bean breeder in Soil and Crop Sciences, and he's found that there are bean varieties that are able to resist the growth of this pathogen, that if you put this fungus on this leaf, it grows slower. And so my laboratory is focusing on the biochemical basis of this, of what are the molecules inside that leaf that is able to slow down the growth of that pathogen. Now, as I was talking, there was a video on the right that was playing, and you slowly saw three potato plants, two of which were essentially wilting and melting. This is a collaboration with Amy Charkowski at the University of Wisconsin-Madison, working with a bacterial pathogen that can do this over the course of a couple days. And as you can see, there is one of these plants was able to resist inoculation with that pathogen. And so again, my laboratory is investigating what is the molecular basis of that. Why is that plant able to resist this pathogen? And is that something that we can potentially breed for? Another area of molecular research that's common not only within a lot of the laboratory space that we have on campus, but really extends to a lot of our research centers, is this concept of flavor stability and appearance. So it's just before lunchtime. So I'm sorry to show you this absolutely beautiful image, because I know everyone wants to take a bite right now. And you probably want to take a bite because it looks good, right? We would call that quality attribute appearance. It has a really nice color. It cooked really well. Would you want to eat it if it was green, if it was spotted? Probably not. So appearance is a really important quality attribute. And there's a molecular basis for that. Now with flavor, you can imagine you look at this photo and you say, oh, that probably smells really good, and it's really important for your food to smell good, because then you want to eat it. And so it's something that you can potentially breed for and generate new flavors and screen all these different, for example, potatoes that are out there and identify ones that have very unique flavor characteristics. And the concept of flavor stability is we're not working with formula-based foods. These are a lot based on fruits and vegetables. And so concept of fruit and vegetable is that their flavor can change over time. And so how can you create a food product from a plant that is able to maintain its flavor characteristics until it can make its way towards the consumer? So some specific work in this area of flavor stability and appearance is with our potato. And so this is work with Sastri Gianti and David Holm, who are at our San Luis Valley Research Center. And they're studying different flavor attributes of different potatoes. And I could tell you I've had some of them, and I want to know what's in it that smells so good. We also have Yanis Minas at the Western Colorado Research Center. He's our departmental pomologist. And he's trying to understand why Colorado peaches, and I don't think there's a better way to phrase this, they're so good. We all know that. We love them. But there's a molecular basis for that. So it could be sugars. You know, they're sweet. But you also know they have this really amazing aroma. And so those aromas are molecular compounds, and there are ways that we can figure out exactly what they are to target them for future breeding and storage endeavors. And he's also working on new methods to use near-infrared spectroscopy to evaluate peach quality while it's still on the tree. A number of us are also involved with flavor stability with the brewing industry. And so my own lab looks at barley and how barley contributes to flavor and flavor stability in different beers. And Bill Bowerly, who's also presenting today, later on in the presentation, is looking at hops. And this is one of the first things that went in our new greenhouse was hops. And so he's looking at the ability he's looking at areas of perpetual production and also the potential of growing hops in a stable environment to have a more stable chemical profile. Continuing with the alcoholic beverage theme, we also have wine research. Steve Menke out at the Western Research Center is our department enologist, and he's also looking for different flavor differences in different wines and different grapes. So shifting a little bit from microbial interactions and flavor, when you think of plant chemicals and food chemicals, you often think of health. We know that there are certain plant chemicals that are absolutely critical to nutrition, meaning we need them, and also health, meaning they present disease. And so there's a real focus in the plant community to try to figure out how we can breed for healthier foods so that the everyday meal at the everyday cafeteria is better for you. And this starts all the way back at breeding and with plant biology. So this general area is called biomedical agriculture, and the founding principle behind this is that agriculture is an instrument for public health. In our department, we study foods such as potatoes, beans, onions, and their preventative effects on chronic diseases such as obesity, cancer, and heart disease, as well as the ability to combat certain disorders such as macular degeneration. Now, I think what makes us unique, because there are a lot of horticulture and plant departments all around the country that are working on these types of areas, but I think what's unique is that, one, we work together, and two, we have a very diverse team. So we have plant breeders. We have people developing different plant varieties. We have plant chemists such as myself and Sastri. And then I think what's really unique about our department is that we have a researcher in human nutrition and health that is Henry Thompson. So I think we are probably the only horticulture department that I can think of that actually houses a cancer prevention laboratory. He has a full lab setup directed by Henry Thompson in which he's able to take different plant-based foods such as potatoes and onions and incorporate them into laboratory-based models to evaluate their effect on cancer, as well as translating that information to the clinic to take this information back to people and out of the laboratory. At this time, I'd like to pass it off to the next scale, which is looking at plants in communities and farms.
Thank you, Adam. So as you can see, I'm going to talk about our research programs that are basically off campus, dealing with the various food crops that are produced in various parts of the state. And I might mention, Steve mentioned, we have a big investment in faculty that are off campus. About one third of the faculty in the Department of Horticulture is located off campus. But we are integrating the department a lot of different ways in terms of committees, whether that be tenure promotion or whatever else that needs to be done at that level or the college or on beyond. So I'm going to take you on a little tour of the state of Colorado. Can't remember what channel on TV had that program. I think it was Saturday evening. They talked about different places in Colorado. Well, we're going to take one dealing with food production in various parts of the state. So I'll start down the Arkansas Valley. And you might want to look sometimes at the Ag Experiment Station's website. They have some weather statistics or basic information related to climate. But the Arkansas Valley is not the longest growing season, but if I recall right, it's around 114 days. A lot of the Front Range tends to be that way and out in onto the plains. But like a lot of these locations around the state, the precipitation, I think Arkansas Valley is 14 inches, the San Luis Valley is 7 inches, and the rest are in between there. So, and then altitude's an important factor there. San Luis Valley is the highest altitude site, about 7,700 foot, and then we go down to lower elevations around 4,000, depending on where you're at. So in the Arkansas Valley, a lot of their emphasis is on vegetable crops, pest management, and production. And I might mention, too, before I get too far into this, that most of these sites, as well as a lot of the research that goes on in our department, I'm sure other departments as well, is I look at it from the standpoint we're looking at three different things. You've heard of a disease triangle, some of you, or other things, but a lot of what we do deals with the genetics or the varieties. It also deals with environment, which is something we can't deal with directly, but we also deal with production management techniques. They help us deal with the environment and work with the genetics we have available to optimize on the efficiency and production of various crops. And see, Mike Bartolo's our faculty member that's located in the Arkansas Valley. Works on tomatoes, onions, corn, melons, peppers, lots of different things. And I think we're all aware how the Arkansas Valley has a reputation for the quality of their melons. Now, some of the other things that Mike's involved in is plasticulture. Otherwise, what's another technique to grow various crops to minimize weed competition, disease maybe in some cases, or extend the growing season? I might make one other point before I get too far, too, is that almost every one of these programs has some degree of interaction or collaboration with people on campus. We won't necessarily go into all those details today, but if you look at any of their information on various websites, you'll find that there. So Mike also works with water use and salinity. So you can see here again, plastic mulch and drip irrigation, furrow irrigation, and so on. Again, all oriented to increase productivity. Mike's also involved to some extent in variety development for peppers. Working with their local industry, they're trying to develop varieties that they might be able to protect from an intellectual property standpoint to come back and help support their program. Let's move on now to the San Luis Valley. Someone was asking me, well, how far are you away from campus? Well, our particular site, you probably ought to figure at least a 5-hour drive to get down to the San Luis Valley. Any direction you come to the valley, you got to go over a mountain pass. And a little commentary, if we have a meeting in San Luis Valley, it's harder for people to get there than it is for us to get to campus. So I don't know what that means, but just a fact of life. So anyway, a lot of what we do there is concentrate on potatoes. You can see an aerial shot of the research center. And if we get a little down closer to the ground, potatoes can be very colorful. And not only what's above ground, but we'll show you some photos of what comes below ground. Well, at the Research Center, we have I would call a good team. In fact, in 2013, we got the Research Team Award, the Potato Cultivar Development Program. We have the Breeding Selection Program, which I manage. We have cultivar management, basically looking at how do we grow different varieties, the recipes necessary, how much nitrogen, when do you apply nitrogen, what kind of spacing, and so on, to optimize those varieties for their production. We've had a pathology component. That particular individual's retired, and he says he's not retired, and I won't mention names. But anyway, he's located here on campus now working part-time, but that's an important part of our team down there. We have a post-harvest physiologist, Sasu Jayante, and we'll talk about their programs briefly. We have a seed certification program, which is involved in tissue culture and disease testing for seed lots. And then we're also invested quite heavily together in looking at nutritional and health aspects of the potatoes. So this illustrates at the research center and all research centers, it's a collaborative process with stakeholders. And this is just a couple examples of visiting with growers out in their field and seeing what's working, discussing what's going on, and so on. Now, if we talk about the potato breeding program, one of those components, you can see here we have a mission statement that is to develop varieties that are productive, competitive, sustainable, and then also we build into that mission statement that they have various consumer attributes, including healthy potatoes. You can see the diverse type of potatoes we have, from russet types, reds, purples with yellow flesh, multicolored skins, multicolored flesh. You know, Adam, in his presentation, mentioned some health attributes, macular degeneration. That particular selection in the bottom center is one that I'm working, and I'll talk maybe a little bit more about that, but Sasu Jayante, working with University of Colorado Health Sciences, was able to find activity in preventing macular degeneration. The one on the lower left, Purple Majesty, a lot of work's been done worldwide, actually, showing its effect on lowering blood pressure. And the mechanism that we don't fully understand, but it's relaxing the vessels and arteries so they're a little more pliable. Now, Samuel Essa does the cultural management, crop management physiology. Before I go further, I might just give a little anecdote here. Samuel first coined this, but talks about how I have the nursery, I have the little babies coming along, and we have a plant pathologist that takes care of health issues along the way, and then we have the post-harvest physiologist. Well, how do you kind of pull some things together there, but Samuel said he always teaches the potatoes how to be good citizens, grow up to be productive. So anyway, we all have our part. But Samuel looks at nutrient management, water management, vine kill, basically anything you can do to a potato, he evaluates that and how that recipe can be put together to improve productivity. Saucery has a three-pronged program in post-harvest physiology looking at storage quality, storage diseases, and nutrition as well. So each of these is a key player in what we're trying to accomplish there. Andrew Hauser, as of more recent, has been trying to fill in from the pathology standpoint as well as now being the manager of our potato certification program. So their purpose is to try to ensure pure varieties and disease-free seed that's going out to the industry. So all of the potatoes that are started in Colorado come through tissue culture programs. And when they hit the field, they're totally, we like to say disease-free, but they've been disease-tested and so on. So they have advanced molecular techniques they're incorporating into their program now. So let's move on over to Western Colorado. Research Center. They have a fairly long growing season there, basically double what we have in the San Luis Valley, which is a little over 90 days. They have about 180. So a lot of what they do is related to fruits. In this case, we'll build on the theme of alcohol, I guess, to some extent. But one thing they're trying to do is looking at cropping reliability. A lot of times when you look at these fruit crops, they may not thrive in some of the environments we're growing them. But part of that not thriving is what imparts quality flavor and so on to those fruits. But one of the issues they have with the grapes is a challenge to meet the environmental conditions of how cold it may get in the winter, even though I don't think it's cold. Grapes apparently think it's cold. And this is an 80,000 pile of grapevines that froze out, and so they just piled in there. But we have Horst Kaspari doing the viticulture program, and then Steve Menke doing the enology program. So growing grapes and then processing grapes into other things. This illustrates on the left, they're talking about within a couple of vineyards that are next door to each other. You can see listed there in yellow, hopefully it's big enough, the various low temperatures. And you can see there's quite a dramatic change in short distances and how much that can impact whether a fruit or a grapevine survives or not. And so they're studying the role of things they can do to prevent and mitigate losses, whether that be introducing new varieties, wherever it may be. And so part of their effort is to, like it shows there, the grapes. It's better to have the grapes than to have a bunch of dead vines piled up. And so they're looking to establish new varieties that have quality, price, demand, and maybe more importantly, cold hardy. So Giannis minus, it almost sounds like an algebra problem. I met him here a few months ago, but he's looking at, as it says here, both abiotic and biotic stresses that happen to grapes. On the left is a disorder. I knew I was not going to say it right. I don't deal with it that much. But anyway, that's a news that's a problem, and they lose a lot of trees. In fact, they did a survey. All the orchard has this particular disorder in them that they surveyed, and then they varied in the number of trees within those orchards. So it's a fairly significant problem, or at least potential to be a problem. Then the little photo in inset is showing what it looks like if you cut into buds of peaches, what they look like after they've been froze. So again, looking at environmental stresses as well as organism stresses, diseases. Another thing that Giannis is doing is looking at biochars, the amendment in peach orchards. I think that's kind of a hot topic these days. We even got a science fair student down in the San Luis Valley looking at biochars. We got some things going on in the greenhouse. So now we're coming back to Fort Collins and touch on some of the work that Mark Uchansky's doing along with Natalie Yoder. He's relatively new to the department, but looking at specialty crops. He came from New Mexico, bringing what he's learned there to Colorado, and he'll be doing a lot more with that information. But a big part of their program is grower grants. I assume that'll be a key component going into the future, but working with growers, a lot of them are small farm operations throughout the state trying to advance specialty crops. And as it mentions here, empowering growers for innovation, competitiveness, and success. So I look forward to seeing a lot more coming out of that program. So with that, I'll turn the time back to Steve Newman to talk about some other things.
Significant part of our program involves growing and producing of ornamental crops, floriculture crops, and turf. And for instance, my own work right now is focusing with a collaborative project with the USDA APHIS Animal Plant Health Inspection service with a laboratory here on campus called the Center for Plant Science Technology, Plant Science Health and Technology with Dr. Craig Ramsey. And we're working with a disease organism, Phytophthora morum, which is an invasive species which is infecting a number of counties on the West Coast, primarily in the Intercoastal Range, California. Since this is a controlled organism, we're doing most of our work currently at the National Ornamental Disease Research Center at Dominican University. And here you can see me working with Dr. Wolfgang
I was going to have his name's longer than I can pronounce. But anyway, we're working with Dominican University to do these projects in a facility that's in the center or hotbed of this disease epidemic. But we're working primarily on looking at with disinfectant technologies, primarily the oxides, hydrogen peroxide, ozone, and also working with chlorine dioxide. And you can see one of my students, Heather Hammack, where she's applying a chlorine dioxide application to rhododendrons for the control of, so that these plants can be shipped throughout the state out of quarantined areas for the nursery industry. The other projects I've worked on includes food safety, where we have a graduate student, Shannon Coleman, working with Dr. Marissa Bunning, and where we're looking at whether or not salmonella infections in the greenhouse, salmonella infections in the irrigation water can be translocated into the tomato fruit. And one of the things that we discovered is that salmonella does not translocate through the plant system, which is a good thing to know. But to work with different programs and work with different collaborations, so working very closely with Dr. Bunning, and we're working on some future projects in food safety in the future. We can't have an ornamental presentation without talking about Dr. Jim Klett's work. Dr. Jim Klett has been with us over 30 years, and part of what he's working with is trialing of ornamental plants, and our bedding plant trials have grown to one of the premier trial grounds in the United States for working with seed companies and breeding companies, putting out the best quality material. Not every plant's going to look good out there. Our site is the highest elevation and the highest hail zone of any of the research centers in North America. And so you can see this is evaluation day, which takes place on the first Tuesday of August. So if you show up at their trial grounds on the first Tuesday of August, they're going to put a laptop in your hand and you're going to take data. Also part of Dr. Klett's work is perennial trials. We have a 20-year perennial trial that's been going over at the Plant Environmental Research Center, and they'll be moving to a new site this summer, probably be complete by the end of the summer, over at the Creative Arts Center. In addition to that, we have an arboretum that's been in place for over 30 years, started by Dr. Bert Swanson, where looking at longtime establishment of many different woody ornamentals. Another significant part of Dr. Klett's research has been working with water and water-efficient plants in the landscape. And here we see Sam Hagopian, one of our master's students, finishing up a turf ornamental grass trial looking at how well these plants establish themselves and how much water they actually use. And part of his research that was shown is that irrigating ornamental grasses at no more than 25% of evapotranspiration is more than enough water for good landscape establishment. Another significant part of our work in our department is with turf. We have two scientists that are involved, Dr. Yaling Chen and Dr. Tony Koski. Part of the work that Dr. Chen has been working on over the years has been working with saltgrass, looking at developing a breeding program for saltgrass that with turf quality. In addition to her work, she's also been working with recycled water. That's water that comes out of the water treatment systems that would normally go in, coming out of the sanitary waste system, that would normally go back into the water that we can put into back into the landscape. So she's been working with projects ever since she's been here, looking at the impact of the recycled water on golf courses, city parks, and the landscape establishment in that area. Some recent work with Dr. Koski has been working on in collaboration with Larimer County Extension Office. Dr. Allison O'Connor is working with turfgrass clippings. Turfgrass clippings are used in by gardeners and used by composters on a large scale. But what happens to those turfgrass clippings if they've been sprayed with a herbicide? And here they're showing that if the turfgrass clippings are harvested too soon after a herbicide application, you can have damage in the vegetable garden. And so we have some quinolac damage on tomatoes. And this is some work that they started last summer that they'll be continuing this year, looking at the impact of clippings. Dr. Jane.
Okay, let me see how this works. All right. Literally right in my face. So I'd like to start by briefly explaining what the profession of landscape architecture is all about for those of you who may not be familiar with it. Many people imagine that landscape architecture is something akin to garden design or the arrangement of plants and other materials in outdoor spaces, and that's certainly an aspect of it, but far from the whole picture. Contemporary practice and research in landscape architecture is not simply an aesthetic exercise, but rather an important and impactful player in many of the big challenges facing humanity. The global human population is growing at a breakneck pace, and more than half of those people live in cities, with the urban share increasing each year. What sort of environment will these people inhabit? How do we create environments that enrich our daily experiences, improve our interactions and our neighbors, and nourish the soul? And how do we do this in a way that is responsible towards the natural environment and our precious shared resources? These are some of the big picture societal and environmental issues that landscape architects grapple with every day. And this is not a new concern for our profession. In fact, this dual interest in society and environment has been there from the beginning. The profession of landscape architecture, as we know it today, was established in the mid-19th century by Frederick Law Olmsted, designer of New York Central Park, and many other well-known urban landscapes across the country. Some of these earliest projects were as much about engineering and natural ecology as they were about experience and aesthetics. One example of Olmsted's famed emerald necklace, Emerald Necklace Park system in Boston, which was essentially an urban scale landscape-based water purification and phytoremediation plan for the foul contaminated waters draining daily into the Charles River and Boston Harbor, but designed in such a way as to provide a place of recreation and respite for the residents of Boston. Oops. With today's concerns over climate change, these challenges remain, but with an even more heightened sense of urgency and the added factor of unpredictability. As the planet warms, damaging storms and extremes in temperature variation are expected to become more frequent and more extreme. In the face of this unknown danger, landscape architects are increasingly concerned with creating environments that are not only engaging and sustainable, but also resilient, capable of responding and adapting to a variety of climatic and meteorological conditions. In this vein, the CSU Landscape Architecture Program is following two branches of research and associated pedagogy that support these imperatives. First is landscape design and theory, which deals with the experiential, social, and aesthetic aspects of landscapes and the creation of healthy, engaging, and equitable public spaces. And the second is urban systems, which deals with the complex interrelationships of infrastructure, economy, natural systems, sustainability, and resiliency. Each of the faculty members in the Landscape Architecture Program is engaged in creative and academic works, which can be broadly categorized under one of these two headings. So the big bet for the Landscape Architecture Program is the melding of these two branches under the topic of healthy, resilient communities. This includes important research into land remediation and reclamation, restoration of natural ecologies, and the design of urban public spaces and civic spaces that encourage greater community cohesion and wellness, healthy lifestyles, low impact on natural resources, and a sustainable or even regenerative future for the world's inhabitants. Professor Merlin Paulson has completed the third year of a four-year research project with the National Park Service in connection with their pilot project called Park Transportation Investment Needs Analysis for Long-Range Transportation Planning. The rollout application park is Golden Gate National Recreation Area, encompassing 23 scenic land parcels north and south of San Francisco that contain rare biological and cultural environments, including the iconic landscapes of the Golden Gate Bridge, Alcatraz Island, and Muir Woods. The pilot program methods consider capital investment, operations, and maintenance strategies along with advanced mitigation planning for climate change impacts and protection of natural and cultural resources, as well as visitor experiences. He's also provided technical services to various communities, including river restoration design and planning for landscapes devastated by the Larimer County flood of September 2013. These are a few of the proposed concept illustrations that he provided for the Glen Haven community. This one is a new footbridge and other infrastructural amenities, and then some sketches for stream restoration. Professor Brad Goetz is engaged in pedagogy and research that explores the historical, cultural, and environmental dimensions of landscape architectural design within the context of society's shifting focus towards more sustainable and equitable public spaces. He has produced award-winning competition proposals and engaged communities to promote healthy and productive landscapes and a higher standard of civic life. Many of the professors, in fact, all of us, are practitioners and apply our research to build projects. This is his design for Our Savior Church in Fort Collins. It's a beautifully, it's a beautifully crafted space incorporating rich local materials in a dynamic composition. Assistant Professor Kelly Curl's research focuses on land reclamation within post-mine landscapes. She's interested in how landscape architects can be involved in the mining process so that reclamation and contour planning of the design site would minimize cost and disturbance while preventing further scarred landscapes. Her research first began in her home state of Pennsylvania, focusing on the anthracite coal region. Through field investigation and case study research, her research methodologies have broadened to engage Colorado mine landscapes. She's currently expanding her research to a more local avenue that would allow her to study an additional variety of mining practices and procedures, as well as study previously reclaimed mining sites. Curl was invited to display her photography exhibit of the anthracite coal region at the opening reception of the 2014 CELA conference at Morgan State University, and she's also received a merit award for the 9 photographic works selected for display, some of which I've just shown you. Associate Professor Joe McGrain is a cultural communicator. He has focused on the importance of placemaking through original site-specific works of art that speak to the history and culture of place, creating memorable, meaningful pieces that connect community to landscape. This piece, entitled Water Crossings, was commissioned by the City of Fort Collins Utility Department and is intended to educate the public about the historical significance and natural ecology of the Poudre River. These are some of the storyboards that he created for this project. McGrain's artscapes, as he calls them, are located throughout Colorado and are described as handcrafted, playful, colorful, and complex environments that connect people to place and to each other. In my own research work, I've been concerned with some of the larger issues of urban systems and infrastructure that impact the livability and sustainability of our cities. In the spring of 2015, I teamed with a large multidisciplinary team including architects, engineers, economists, developers, marine biologists, and other experts to produce a design proposal for the Boston Living with Water competition. Our proposal addressed multiple interrelated issues impacted by climate change and rising sea levels, including protection of structures and infrastructure systems from storm surge, restoration of marine wildlife habitat, creation of new recreational opportunities, design of multi-tiered constructed wetland system to purify storm and wastewater, enhanced green infrastructure for stormwater management, and provision of a renewable energy source to power the new waterfront district based upon tidal flow energy. The proposal was chosen as one of 12 finalists in this major international competition and was an innovative approach to the challenges of urban coastal resiliency. The success and resonance of that project led me to become involved as one of the leaders of the Eco District's VPR Catalyst for Innovative Partnership team. And it's a broad interdisciplinary group of experts, as you can see here, with municipality, public and private interests. Following the Eco District's protocol developed in Portland, Oregon, our group is currently in the research and fundraising stages of designing and implementing Colorado's first Eco District here in Fort Collins. We are establishing long-term public and private partnerships to realize this goal, which provides for an ecologically responsible, economically healthy, and socially vibrant and equitable urban district that will serve as a template for future development. Overlapping the work that is done in our program, Associate Professor Zach Johnson is a landscape architect in the Landscape Business and Landscape Design and Contracting program. His expertise is in residential and small-scale commercial design, emphasizing sustainable construction techniques. His work has largely been focused on green infrastructure and site-specific strategies for stormwater management, such as this bioremediation garden in collaboration with the Coca-Cola Company in Denver. Johnson has also collaborated with Dr. Michael Steger, Associate Professor of Psychology at CSU, on research relating the benefits of landscapes to the physical and psychological health of communities. In his work, he's shown how landscapes support the triple bottom line of sustainability. This example is one specific project he has studied, Via Verde, in the Bronx. Beyond the easily recognizable ecological benefits of this project, there have been demonstrated economic improvements in the form of greater workplace productivity for nearby businesses, as well as the social benefits that accrue from greater community interaction and cohesion. And so now I'd like to introduce Dr. Bill Bowerly, who will present research concerning environmental horticulture.
Thanks, Jane. So part of what horticulture is all about is integrating the latest technology that we have so that we can try to get to bigger production scales, hopefully trying to optimize those production scales. And I don't have to convince anybody in this room here in Colorado that water is a very important issue. So I primarily am working with water relations of plants, but I was also involved in this national coordinated agricultural project funded by the USDA to a tune of roughly $6 million to try to develop using wireless sensors, wireless sensor nodes, integrating all of that data to come back so that we can now schedule irrigation at very large production scales. So for example, I was specifically working at a 900-acre outdoor nursery production facility in Ohio, and by using this technology, we could not only relay the information coming from the sensors, but the wireless nodes now have control capabilities, which allow us now to send signals and turn on things like solenoids so that we can then water them appropriately. And so this was a coordinated agricultural project involving Carnegie Mellon University, the Robotics Institute, myself and a team of others here at Colorado State University, University of Maryland, Cornell, and also University of Georgia. And then the main industry company was Decagon Devices, which is similar to Campbell Scientific, where they would actually manufacture these nodes now that we could then deploy them basically in these data networks, receive the information, and then send signals back. So I was actually able, from my office or anywhere that I had an internet connection, to schedule the irrigation at the site in Ohio, which is pretty powerful. So now these growers have a tool, if you will, so that they can control their crop production based on the amount of water that the plants are actually in need of. And one of the things that, no matter how much the sensors become cheaper, technology definitely drives that price down, but sensors are always going to cost money. The data loggers, what have you, computers are always going to cost money. So I was primarily responsible for developing three-dimensional plant models that basically I use an indirect genetic approach to actually now be able to predict the plant's transpiration in three dimensions, and then on a genotype-specific basis, control the irrigation based on how those different genotypes are using water. So for example, in red maple, which is a common landscape tree in the east, there's a lot of variation just within the species in the amount of water that it uses. And so we can actually schedule those different cultivars and genotypes differently so that we're applying the right amount of water to then optimize the system. At the same time, this technology is very well grounded in biology, so I also collaborate with John McKay in VSPM, where we can actually apply the same type of technique in Arabidopsis to actually predict then the different genotypes' transpiration. And then in order to scale this up to an even larger level, Patrick Martin, who's also in our department, takes it now to the forest ecosystem-wide scale. So he uses models similar to the type I use to actually now predict the recruitment, the mortality, the growth and light interception of different forest ecosystems to try to then determine how those systems are going to change over time in response to climate change. And so he and I collaborate together as well to now bring all of this technology together where I can use these three-dimensional plant models that actually predict the carbon flux, the transpiration, then place those plants within a stand of trees, and now with the environmental interactions that greatly really influences the biology of the plant and how it's going to respond to it. So we can use things like geographic information systems to then scale that up to an entire portion, if not the whole United States. And then by on-the-ground measurements still, we can validate those models to see how well they are predicting how the plants are going to respond to climate change, how the forest might change, what have you. So again, it's really about bringing all this latest technology together so that we can then take it to that much larger scale. And we also do work at the global scale to then predict how that climate change is going to affect different regions of the world, if you will. And so with that, I'm going to hand it back over to Dr. Newman to finish off the presentation.
So in closing, it's appropriate for we talk about other relationships we have in our department, and that is our department, our program investment in extension and engagement. Part of our engagement programs include very active working with the Master Gardener program. In fact, Master Gardener training is happening as we speak. Dr. Tony Koski is traveling and doing Master Gardener presentations. Another strong program we have in our department is the Plant Select. Plant Select is a collaborative program with Denver Botanic Gardens, introducing good quality plant materials, mostly perennials, for the Colorado and the Front Range of the United States, the Front Range of the Rocky Mountains, for good plants, strong plants for our industry. Evaluating trees, evaluating perennials, evaluating different plant materials. All of our faculty are heavily involved in engagement with our own industries. The landscape architects are involved in working directly with the Institute for Built Environment, make sure that CSU stays at the forefront of working with these different groups. Teaching. We have a strong teaching program. We have a strong investment in teaching. Most of our programs require internships where we place our students on the ground working in commercial operations, preparing them for good careers. Most of our students have opportunities to work with our research programs, very actively involved. Service learning, encouraging our students to get out and work in the community. Student employment, we have a strong effort in making sure our students have access to good quality employers. We have several very strong and very active clubs. Our Hort Club program is recognized on a national level and a regional level with the Mid-American Collegiate Horticulture Society. Pi Alpha Xi is one of our honor program, honor society, where our students, we recognize our students for high achievement academically and working with our faculty. Student Society for American Society for Landscape Architecture, very actively involved, and we have annual landscape architecture days on a regular basis where we bring in professionals from across the United States and internationally. One of our premier programs, I think, was our Women in Landscape Architecture program a number of years ago. SOLDAC, our Society of Landscape Design Contracting Students, they're preparing right now for the student career days, which can be hosted at Mississippi State University. We regularly bring home the trophy, and Turf Club. Turf Club is very active, often participating in what's called the Turf Bowl and making impacts in our working with our industries. Many of our students go on to work at in sports venues, Coors Field, the Denver Mile High Stadium, several of our baseball fields across the country, and many of our major golf courses across the country employ our students. So at this point, I think it's time for questions.
What is the LED lighting in the new Horticulture Center, other than increased efficiency? Can you talk to what differences that lighting system might have?
What Diane is referring to is we have a new state-of-the-art lighting system installed in our new Horticulture Center. And exactly what happened is almost within days of moving forward with building of the new Horticulture Center, I had an opportunity to work with Philips Horticulture Lighting. Most of us know, most of us have a Philips product in our house, if not mostly Philips products in our houses with lighting systems. We had an opportunity of building a brand new system to implement a brand new technology with a significantly reduced purchase of state-of-the-art lighting technology that came out of research and development in Eindhoven, Holland in July of 2015. The systems were installed in by our facilities team in throughout December and January. The lighting technology involves very specific wavelengths targeted at photosynthesis. So all of the light energy that's going into those plants is light energy that they will use. In other words, if you look at those plants exposed to the LED lighting technology, the leaves actually turn black to your own vision because all the energy going into that plant is being consumed by the chlorophyll molecule. The technology we've installed is almost to the 42% more efficient, or they consume 42% of the light that a similar system in LED in high-intensity discharge sodium lights. Sodium lights are primarily rich in the yellows and oranges. These lights are primarily rich in red, far red, magenta, and royal blue. So we're focusing on just the lights that plants use, and it's much more efficient. And part of my research, as well as others, will be migrating towards exploring how to efficiently use these lighting systems for production.
Can you repeat the question so it goes on tape?
How did the Arkansas Valley get its name? Well, that's a good question. I would say probably because the Arkansas River.
Okay, so it runs right through there? Mm-hmm.
Very close.
I don't live there. Okay. And it's a valley, so it's spread out, but yeah. You get out of that valley, there's not much activity as far as ag. It's pretty important, that water.
So, Bill, one of the things you talked about was the capture of huge amounts of data. And in the previous two seminars, we've heard that one of the gaps that we have here is how do we handle big data? How are you dealing with that, and what do you see as the needs for the future?
Well, there's no question that, you know, the way that we have technology today, we can capture a lot of data real quickly, and then how do we deal with it? So in our system, we're able to archive it. You can go back and, you know, rerun, if you will, different portions of the data. So I guess it'll depend on the situation, but one of the best ways we found to do it is to archive it into very specific time groups, and then that way we can reuse it, if you will, to make sure that everything's running correctly. So, yes.
Thank you. I have a question about when we're looking at all these new varieties being developed, whether it's potatoes or peppers or whatever, one of the concerns, and I know Dave addresses this many times, is the horticultural acceptability for the growers or producers using these varieties. But how do you tie that in with your health benefits? When you're looking at something, we mentioned several times how genotype has a different ability to do whatever. How do you tie that in so that the producers understand that this is a good product for them to raise, and can they get more money at the store when it's all said and done?
I think the first thing you need to do is track health traits. So you need to be monitoring all the varieties that you're developing and determining what health traits are there and how much are in there, which varieties are most ideal. The other challenge is convincing growers that it is something they need to care about and that it's important for your particular industry. You're at the grocery store, you're competing against everything else that's in there. And so it's important that the consumer understands that your particular product is also healthy when your competing products may be posing the same claims.
So Jane, as we look at changes in climate, changes in the environment, how is landscape architecture, what is the future? How do you see that you will have adaptive environments?
There has been a huge shift in the way that landscape architects are now approaching landscape. It's not a static condition anymore. We're really taking sort of a proactive response, thinking about strategies that really sort of accept climate change and these conditions. And so wetlands, bioswales, all of these things are now, you know, an integral part of the way we design. Green infrastructure is an integral part of the way we design landscapes, and we want to design landscapes that will be resilient, but also maybe even thrive under some of these storm surges or harsh conditions. It's really just a change in our strategy.
So in many areas around the world, in our urban communities, there has long been utilization of rooftops for incorporating ornamental and food crops into the urban environment. We don't see that here in Colorado. Do you have any plans for incorporating vegetated roofs in the Colorado urban landscapes?
I think we've talked about this. if we get more rain, maybe. right now, we are looking more at strategies for living walls. I think because we can control the exposure a little bit better. Green roofs are really tough, and I really don't know enough about that technology. But obviously, it's improving every day. But living walls are something that we're building here in Fort Collins a lot more. And we're going to see if that's a more successful. It has a lot of the benefits of green roofs. Thank you.
Other questions?
Hi, I'm not sure who to direct it to, but I guess just generally I'm wondering if there's an interest within the department in what one might call medicinal plants.
I believe Jorge Vivanco, who I mentioned with respect to runs the Center for Rhizosphere Biology, does do some work with medicinal plants.
In addition to a new area that Dr. Vivanco is going into, is he's starting to work with some organizations out of Peru, bringing in new germplasm in stevia, and then working with some other medicinal qualities of plants out of South America.
So this is probably for Jane. I see that landscape architecture is basically one of the few parts in the college, few departments in the college that directly interacts with the general population, what we call the consumers. So do you guys work at all on what determines adoption of certain type of plants, landscape, try to understand consumer choice and those kinds of issues?
Yes, absolutely. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah, absolutely. You know, the profession has really changed over the span of 50 years. It used to be a very autocratic, authoritarian process of the government or architects, you know, telling, you know, here's the master plan and you're going to love it, and they're going to raise entire neighborhoods and build these communities and have the community basically accept it and live there. That has been a huge failure in our society, and now we're taking a more bottom-up approach, and communities are much more involved. My involvement with the Eco District is a district scale type of strategy where we're looking at smaller interventions, smaller policy changes. That way we can interface with the community leaders and municipality developers and make positive change in a quicker, more cost-effective way. So it really is involving community more, and it has to.
Any final questions?
Build on that last point, because I'm very curious about the details of how civil society gets engaged as opposed to their governmental representatives, for example.
Well, I know that even city planners here in Fort Collins are they're much more engaged with the community as well. It used to be that they would have an open house or open forum, and community would come and voice their opinions, give feedback. Now, the city is actually going to where the people are. They're actually setting up pop-up booths and really trying to educate and get them much more involved, an active blog site, website. As far as what landscape architects do and designers, we've always been communicating with community members. We have charrettes, we have design workshops, and it just continues to increase. I mean, any way that we can involve community, it's for the benefit of everyone.
So it was mentioned that the department is really growing, and I was wondering what the department is doing to increase or maybe sustain that growth, as well as promote more diversity in the students that are coming into the department.
We would love more money. One of the things that we strongly work with is trying to be inclusive in all of our programs, working on building a diverse base, working hard to make sure that the students that come to us feel welcome. We have taken to heart the concept of family, much like the College of Agricultural Sciences has done, in that we treat our students and treat our faculty as family as much as we can. Our programs are growing. We're being creative in how our courses are being prepared. We're putting together a strong online component. We're working closely with Front Range Community College to provide a smooth transition for students coming from the community college level to coming to the university. Like I said, we're working on an online program. We are releasing in 2016 a degree completion program. Where students are not required to come to CSU, trying to work with our diverse clientele, making sure that our students are well prepared to go into work in the industry. A significant portion of the labor force in horticulture are minority groups that maybe English isn't their first language, so we're making sure our students are prepared by putting them in the workplace with internships. More than anything else is we would like to see our department grow in faculty numbers, and it all means money.
Any final questions? If not, I'd like, oh, Blue.
My question is a very positive one. You folks are in HLA. What is the very best urban landscape in the world? Any of the five of you?
Lou asked the question, what is it's not really what's the best landscape in the world. It's not the best landscape, it's probably what our favorite is. And as far as urban development, urban renovation, probably my favorite is Providence, Rhode Island. back in the 50s and 60s, they took a series of rivers in Providence, Rhode Island, and I don't know which river it is, but they covered them all up with streetscapes, and turned it into a very declining neighborhood, and it got fairly dangerous and such as that. And they, about 15 years ago, 20 years ago, they took all those streets, tore them up, created what's called Firewater. They have programs all summer long where they have bonfires that are built into the river, and they've created several different scenic scapes where the you'll have performing arts, people just casually strolling down the waterways. They have a very strong farmers market. It just is a very, very interactive and very calming place to visit. And so it's not really the best. It's one of my favorites.
One last question. If not, before we thank them, I'd like to remind you that next Friday the 4th of March, we have the Agricultural and Resource Economics Department making their presentation. So I hope to see you all back here, and thank you very much for a wonderful presentation.